to go ahead and get started with the R demo. I'll go ahead and go up to Scott Steinberger.
Sorry, I'm getting out of the way.
Hey, Jeff, can you turn off the lights on the projector?
Hello, everyone. My name is Scott Steinberg, and I'm in charge of membership development in the CNU Sports and Analytics Club. And today, myself and our president, Jeff Phillips, are going to be leading you guys through a R demo using the NFL Screamer R package that many of you guys will be using for the Target Data Science Cup tomorrow. How many of you guys are going to be doing that? All right, good amount. So what you guys see here is, so if you go on the link to our conference website and you scroll down to right around here, and where it says demonstration files can be downloaded here. So if you click that, we can go through the demonstration file together, and it should look something like this. And let me zoom in on this.
So sorry to interrupt, Scott. So hopefully you folks. Sure. Hopefully you folks have already downloaded R, which is the language we'll be working with, as well as our interpreter in Shell, which is R Studio. If not, the links are also on the website there for you.
Okay. So first of all, I'm going to get into what kind of file this is. So this is an R markdown file. So basically, as we're going through this code, we're going to run each chunk of code. Like, for example, as you can see, once we start talking about libraries, and I can run this chunk of code to run every single line of this code, and we're just going to keep doing that until towards the end, and we're going to see how we can knit and turn this R markdown file into an HTML file. And so we're going to get into that, but first I'm going to reintroduce the NFL Scraper package, which Ron talked about in great detail in his talk earlier today, and Max brought up too in his talk. So Max and Ron and Sam Ventura, who you guys all heard from today, they started this package a few years ago to take NFL play-by-play data from the NFL website, and they take data for teams, players, and play-by-play, so data for every single play of the game, and it's a great resource for football analysis, and this kind of play-by-play data can also be used for baseball or hockey, and there's also good resources that are out there for basketball.
All right, great. So we're going to start again with our first code chunk. So if you scroll down, we're at like line 22 here. So the way I like to think of an R markdown file is it's sort of like your notebook, right? So it's got your code chunks in it, as well as maybe your notes and sort of the things you're trying to convey about your code and the visualizations that you drive. So our first section here, you'll see it's delimited by these sort of exclamation point looking things. And then it says R, warn equals false, message equals false. Those are just internal commands for when we knit the file. But the three lines of importance are our library files, or our library calls. So a library in R is a collection of functions and methodology. And they're pre-written for us. And what we're going to do is call upon three different ones specifically. So the NFL Scraper, you'll see, is commented out there using the hashtag or the number sign. We're going to comment that one out just because of sort of traffic issues with the NFL site. We don't want all you guys crashing the NFL site, trying to run through all the data sets and pull game data for every single game of the season. But we are going to use Tidyverse and Plotly. So the Tidyverse is probably the most commonly used R package. It encapsulates a lot of other packages like ggplot, we'll get into later, as well as dplyr. Like lubricate, stuff like that. You can read about it. There's tons of documentation online on the website. And then Plotly is an extension of that, which will help us to generate dynamic graphs and interactive charts. All right. So we're going to get our data from Ron's GitHub page, and they're going to be in the form of CSVs, comma-separated value files. You can also read like Excel text files, as long as you know what the delimiting character is. Okay, so great. So Scott, if you want to go ahead and run that chunk, the one that starts at line 30, so that play button is going to run this entire chunk, and I'll sort of get into exactly what we're doing in this chunk. So you'll notice when you hit that play button, a bunch of stuff popped up over here in our environment, and the environment's going to describe all of our local variables. So a local variable is sort of something that we've loaded into our environment to save for later, and to so we don't have to just keep making the same function call, we just have it saved. So it will be saved in like your CPU. And then, so the first line, line 31 there, so what we're going to do is we're going to save a string, which is a data type of characters. We're going to save this string, which is our URL for our data, and we're going to call it the game passing URL. And then from there, we're going to read the CSV, so we're going to call it read CSV command from that string. So Scott, here's an interesting, like here's one of the ways that I would go about learning R is if I need help with a command, you can just type right in the console, help, and then your command. And then it'll pop up here on the right. And it'll tell you sort of what arguments it needs. One of those arguments being the URL, and that's the one that we provided today. So I want to pause right here and say, you guys are more than welcome to ask for questions. If you guys are having trouble following along, please raise your hand. We'll come around and help you guys out. So we've done that with the game passing data. So that would be aggregates for quarterbacks over games. We also have season passing data. So again, aggregates over a season. And then we also have the play-by-play, PVP 2017. So again, that's going to have your statistics for every play that's been run in 2017 for all games. And you'll be able to sort of interpret which game it is and what the outcome of the play was based on the columns in that data frame. All right.
And also, I'd like to show another way that you can get your data sets into R. So if you go into Ron's website, Ron's GitHub website, and say we want to click 2017 play-by-play, and we want to insert our data in this way, then we can just click the download button right here, and it'll show you the CSV, and what we can do is we can save this page as, and as the default, it'll format to comma-separated values, which are CSV files. So, like, if I was to save this, and I'd replace that because it was already saved for me. But another way,
could you open that file?
Yeah, good, good. Just open it in Excel so you can see.
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah. So this is what a CSV file looks like in Excel. Yeah, and it's a pretty big data set, so it's going to take a little while to load. Yeah, as you can guys see. So this is what the play-by-play data set will look like, and so this is one way to do it. So like, you see that CSV file on Excel, and if you want to get it onto R, then you can just go to File, Import Data Set from CSV, and then you can just pull it in from right there, and if I wanted to do that. So that's just another way to do it. So now that we have the data sets in our environment, so if I wanted to view, let's say, the game passing data frame, then I can just click the game passing data frame and it'll just show up here. Also, you can see on the console, I use the view function with a capital V, as in view game passing data frame, and it'll just show that data set in R. So like, for example, so like Ben Roethlisberger on this game against the Titans in 2009 at 43 attempts, 33 completions, and so on. And it's a pretty deep data set, and if you want more detailed descriptions about what each of these numbers are, then just look on Ron's page for that.
Yeah, so so a lot of those columns are going to be, again, like the outcome of the play. Some of them are binary variables. I'm like, hey, was this a touchdown, 1 or 0? But there are also then a lot of sort of Ron's metrics, like his expected points added and stuff like that, like win probability. So there's a bunch of like sort of your functional variables as well as like your analytical ones.
Yeah, and so we can say view game passing data frame to see this data frame here, or if we just type in the game passing data frame. So like if I just run this, then it will just kind of show the header. So like, it's like pretty much the first things you'll see when you're looking at this data set. It's like the first thing you see is Ben Roethlisberger. So that's just another way to like take a very brief look at it. And so now that we have these data sets, we can start making plots. And we can do this using the ggplot function, which is in the tidyverse package. So what ggplot does is it allows you to make really cool visualizations. So in this case, we want to look at each player's single game stats since the year 2009 and see, let's say you want to make a histogram of how many times a player throws for, say, a certain number of yards. And so I'm just going to run this chunk of code and show you guys a histogram that can be made. So like if you set passing yards for the variable that we want to look at, and if we want to make a histogram, I'll just show the frequency of how often players will pass for that number of yards. And so I'm going to walk you guys through that, and please feel free to stop me if you have any questions. So I'm going to call the ggplot function to say I want to make a graph. And then when you call that ggplot function, the first thing you need to do is you need to put in the data set. So in this case, we're using the game passing data frame because we're looking at the statistics for each specific game. And then the aesthetic function here, so this is where we implement the variables that we're looking at. In this case, we're really just looking at the total yards, and since we're only implementing one variable, it will say that, okay, the other variable would just be the frequency. And now we want to draw a histogram. And the way we do this is we use the geom histogram color, or the geom histogram function. And to play around with the visualizations, we can set the color equal to black. So like, if you see on this graph, like the outline is black, and then the fill is a dark blue, which we would just say by fill equals dark blue. And then we have our lattice function, which is where we can put in the labels, the axis titles that we have here. So like, if we want to say title equals passing yards by quarterbacks, and as you can see on the graphs, that's what the title is. And subtitle would be each game since the 2009 season, which you can also see on the graph. And you can see our caption and our name for our x-axis and y-axis as well. And so now that I've gone through with you guys on how to make this graph, I'm just going to ask anyone in the audience if they can sense anything particularly weird about this graph here.
So remember, this graph is, so this is your passing yards by quarterbacks game on game.
Yeah.
So there are some distribution concentrated around zero.
Yeah.
But does that really count as a pass?
Yeah. So in this particular data set, there's a lot of players who have passing yards like closer to zero than we would anticipate for a quarterback playing a full game. And the reasoning behind this is because this data set also includes players who only threw, say, one, two, three pass attempts in a game. They may have just thrown a pass in the Wildcat offense. They may have filled in for an injured quarterback in the fourth quarter, and thus were given a very small sample size of pass attempts during the game. And now Jeff's going to talk about how we can go about that.
Yeah, so by the way, great answer. And so this is how you would go about sort of like tuning your data set, kind of figuring out what your issues are. This is sort of still your like exploratory piece. So this little chunk here, so all this is going to do, and I'll go line by line in a second, but all it's going to do is take your game passing data frame and just select certain columns to look at. And then the arrange thing, the arrange line there, is going to sort it on a specific column. So what we did here is, so the big thing to realize here is that you have this percent greater than percent operator, which is called like your piping operator. And all this does is it's a way to neaten up your code. It just takes the thing on the left side and inserts it as the first argument on the function that's below it. So like here we have game passing df piped into select. So that's just specifying your data set for that next function. So that's a very commonly used part of the tidyverse. I believe it's within the dplyr package. So now we have our data frame. We're selecting four columns, and we are arranging it by total yards. And once we do that, it generates this table here. And as we suspected, yeah, there are a lot of players that only have one attempt in a game.
It's like Anquan Boldin there on the third line, so he's like his wide receiver. So to sort of filter our graph down to only the quarterbacks that we want to look at for the histogram, what we're going to do is make use of the filter function within the tidyverse, which is within Flyer. So you'll see on line 77 there, we're going to instantiate a new data frame, and it's just going to be a filtered version of our previous data frame. And our criteria is that the attempt should be greater than or equal to 25. So this should be a quarterback that throws for 25 or more attempts in a game. So the only thing that changes really in our function call, the ggplot call on line 79, is we just specify a different data frame. And we also change the subtitle as well. But yeah, Scott, if you scroll down a little bit, you'll see there's your histogram. Yeah, we sort of arrive at like some of the normal distribution, kind of as expected. All right, so now I'm going to try to get you guys involved a little bit more. So what we're going to do now is filter down to a specific quarterback. Just want to see a histogram distribution. Anybody want to raise their hand and give their favorite quarterback?
Maybe nobody has a favorite quarterback?
Multiple teams. Tom Brady. Tom Brady. All right, this is going to be a very interesting draft, but we'll chill. So yeah, so again, we're filtering on the player. And so the sort of new concept I was hoping to introduce in this graph was the facet function. So the you see the facet grid argument down below. So what a facet does is it partitions your data set based on some variable, and we went by team here. So Scott has now switched it to Carson Palmer. You know, he's played for three teams since 2009, and here you have three sort of identical graphs and setup with different data based on what the team was. So we were talking about it, like another nice facet might be to just look at a team and then facet by the quarterback that's playing, right, Scott?
Yeah. So, like for example, if you want to look at the different numbers for each of the Cleveland Browns quarterbacks, because they've had a lot of them.
This is a nightmare graph.
Yeah, this is
not player.
So as you can see, the Browns went through like 12 different quarterbacks in the last 8 years.
Yeah.
And
that's just with at least 25 attempts.
Yeah, that's just with at least 25 attempts. And as you can see, the x-axis is a little bit messed up just because our pretty big sample size, to say the least.
I think the one that when we were playing this, we were thinking the Packers, right? The Packers looks kind of nice.
Yeah,
the
Packers are another good example because they've mostly utilized Aaron Rodgers for obvious reasons, but Aaron Rodgers has had some injury problems, and maybe they rely on Matt Flynn or Scott Tolzien.
Yeah, so I guess like maybe this graph doesn't provide the most utility, but what it would provide is like, hey, clearly Aaron Rodgers is frequently starting games at least, or having 25 attempts. And then if you look at the graphs side by side, you can tell that, you know, Rodgers tends to go from more yards than the other guys. All right. Great. So we're going to get into sort of a more interesting graph this time. And we're going to use the expected points added model that Ron spoke about at length before. Okay, great. So what we're going to do is we're going to use a scatter plot, call it Geom Point here in R. And what we're going to look at is clutch EPA, so that's your expected points added in clutch situations. We're going to look at that versus your success rate, which again is the proportion of plays that you would run with a positive expected points added. So you're having a success on a throw, you're adding value to your team. All right, so, and again, you can read about that model up there. So here's your basic scatter plot. So here you have, again, success rate on the X, total clutch EPA on the Y. I don't think we introduced anything really in the code. But what we're going to do is get a little bit more granular with it. So if you scroll back down to the graph for a second, Scott, you'll see there's sort of a positive association there, right? But I think a more interesting thing, so each point represents a quarterback. What we're going to do is make it so that each point, instead of being a dot, is going to be a label with the text of that quarterback. So you can see, hey, who's doing really well, who has a high GPA, who has a high success rate. So that's going to be, so actually what I should mention, what we're going to do is we're going to comment out certain pieces of code and uncomment other pieces of code. So when you write a comment, that's code that won't be run by your interpreter. So that's what we're utilizing in the number sign provision. So you see we've commented out g on point, we're going to add in g on text, and we're going to specify the label as the player name. So here you can see in 2017 we've got Tom Brady and Alex Smith at the top right, which is sort of where you want to be in this graph. And then you guys got guys like Matt Cassel, Sean Kizer, Carson Palmer's kind of down there as well. And then another thing we can do with this graph is sort of confirm our suspicion earlier that, hey, maybe these two things are related in a positive manner. And the way we're going to do that is just by drawing a simple linear model. So we're going to do the method of least squares to fit a linear model in the graph. So you can go ahead and scan it. So yeah, so it's drawn it there. And then the shaded regions would be sort of like your confidence interval on either side of the line. So it's like a conditional confidence interval at each point. And you can hide the shaded region if you want by just adding in as an argument standard error SE equals false.
As you see, we also input theme underscore BW. And what that means is that, as you can see on the graph, the background is white and the outlines are black. So that's really all that means.
Right.
Yeah. So now what we're going to do is dive a little bit further into success rate and use it as a way to compare two players. And like for example, like the two players that you may want to compare are Eli Manning and Philip Rivers, who are two quarterbacks who were taken in the 2004 NFL draft and both went on to have very successful careers. And you might ask yourself, okay, what if I want to graph their success rates over the duration of their career? Or the rate over the duration since 2009, because that's as long as we have the data. So as you can see here, since 2009, Philip Rivers has had a higher success rate than Eli Manning for pretty much every single season. And so I'm going to walk you guys through this graph. So you're looking at the two variables, so that would just be season success rate. And the way that we differentiate these two colors is, so we set this color variable to be equal to player name, and the default colors that we have here would just be orange for Eli Manning and blue for Philip Rivers, but the color equals player name condition just specifies that we want different colors for these two players. And then like g on line function is just size of the line. So like for example, if I made it size equals 3, then the lines would be a little bit thicker. And yeah, so one more thing I want to touch on. So if you look at this graph and you look at the labels for the x-axis, so we have like 2010.0, 2012.5, and 2015.0 to represent the seasons. Well, first of all, we don't think of years in terms of decimals, and yeah, that's really the main point. And 2012.5, that season really doesn't have any sort of significance whatsoever. So the way we would go about that is to implement this scale x continuous function, and what that does is it allows you to set the labels on the x-axis to what you want them to be. So, or set the breaks in this case. So what I would want to do is set them from 2009 to 2017 to really show how their success rates differentiate from each season. And the way I'm doing it is I'm saying 2009:2017, which is just another way of saying every integer between 2009 and 2017 inclusive. And now it happens when I run this code, and
I think the plus sign has to be on the line before.
Oh yeah, I think so. Yeah, so like what you guys will see here is that the x-axis looks a lot smoother. And now that we have this player one, player two comparison, and we can do a lot of interesting analysis with this. So if you guys just want to shout out your favorite quarterbacks, then we can just compare them.
I'm going to say Tim Tebow. We've got to throw him up there.
Oh, absolutely.
Is he your favorite quarterback?
He's my favorite baseball player. What do you guys got? What are your favorite quarterbacks?
Did you just yell out a name?
Chad Pennington.
I think he has.
We'll find out.
I think so.
Breaks. There you go. Superstar.
Like,
yeah.
Literally, right at the border.
Tim Tebow was never Chad Pennington since 2009.
And say we want to look at three players. So, we can say Peyton Manning, Eli Manning, and I mean, we can try Cooper Manning, but would that result in an error?
I don't think so. Yeah.
No, it would be an error.
Yeah, he's not in there.
He's just not in there. Yeah, it'll just be Eli versus Peyton.
And what you see there is similar to Brian Burke has had a post before on the end of quarterback careers, where it's not necessarily like a gradual decline like you'd see in other sports like baseball, typical aging curve. Some football quarterbacks, right, we just have this immediate drop-off. Part of it's maybe the fact that he's experienced this massive drop-off in a single season, and he thinks he just doesn't have it anymore, and the team thinks, well, we just don't want to deal with this anymore, potentially. It's a lot different than the random variation we see maybe across baseball seasons. So that's just something to point out here, is it's a massive decline in one season for quarterback.
Yeah. So it's like instead of doing the three Mannings, we can do Peyton, Eli, and say another Colts QB, Andrew Luck. And then this plot will just show the comparison between those three.
All right, great. So we're going to take a deeper dive now into a more interesting graph. Yeah, keep going now. Oh, yeah, sorry, I should mention. So, yeah, a great resource for just writing up ggplot code is that link that we put up there. It's a great cheat sheet. It'll explain pretty much any command that you're going to use, and it's pretty useful. It'll give you all the syntax, so I highly encourage you to use that. But, yeah, let's go to the win probability charts. So let's run the code just to show the output. So a lot of you guys have probably seen win probability charts before. Basically, you have on your X your time remaining, on your Y your win probability, and it shows sort of the evolution of the game flow. You know, what team was favored when, and then so there's always an underlying model behind win probability. Brian has his own. Brian was saying he's got his own as well. So it's always interesting to compare those. For now, we're going to use the one with an NFL scraper. So each play-by-play line, each row, is actually going to have its own win probability attached to it for both teams. All right, great. So let's dive into the code a little bit. All right, so our first line, 151, is going to just, we're going to instantiate sort of this graph object as oak_KC_name. We're going to start with our data, which is PVP 2017. And then we're going to filter it out for a specific game. So your game ID is that can actually be found on the NFL website. Basically, on the URL that you're going to, you'll see like a game ID tag on it. And you'll be able to pull in that way. And then those next four lines are to sort of delete the rows that won't provide us data that that is useful. So that's going to be like stop music play, times where we have null values in seconds remaining, as well as home and away win probabilities. All right, and then our next line is our ggplot function, and then our aesthetic. So this is going to draw the canvas, and it's going to say, hey, on our x, we want the time remaining in the game. And then we have our three lines. So the first line that we're going to draw is the one in the middle, and that's sort of like your neutral line, 50% win probability line. And then the next two correspond to the home and away win probabilities. And then the next two lines, your annotations. Just to draw your labels so we can label each line, then you can color them accordingly. You can play around with all those arguments if you want. You'll see we actually specify X and Y values, so we're actually placing it right on the graph using those values.
And then, yeah, another interesting piece of the code would be your scale X reverse. So basically what that's going to do is it's just going to flip your scale on the X, because we're looking at time remaining in the game. So we really want, on the right side, we want there to be 0 seconds left, and we want to start at the inception of the game. So we've got that, and then your breaks are going to be at the end of each quarter. And the Y limb, that statement is just to limit the data, or I'm sorry, limit the graph to start from 0 at the bottom and 1 at the top. So that would be like your proportion of limit percentage. And then you've got your familiar labels function, as well as your mean, black, and white. And so Scott, if you want to just show them what that graph looks like without using the plot link, like you just want to type in the console, you just do oak underscore KC underscore deal. And it'll draw it over there. So this is what the ggplot would look like. We just added one more facet to it by introducing the plotly. So this is, again, the library we were talking about earlier, which will just give you an interactive graph. You'd be able to hover over certain sections of the graph and learn key pieces of data about it. So it specifies what your win percentage probability would be each different point. And yeah, so this is an exciting game, right? Because you have it jumping over and over from, you know, Oakland's favorite to win this game and Kansas City's favorite to win this game. And then wanted to mention this graph actually broke NFL Scraper, because I don't know if you remember on this Thursday night game, there were penalties at the end, and Oakland ended up winning on a play that was called 0 seconds remaining.
That's three times.
Yeah, exactly.
Three times there's no time on the clock, and the models need time remaining. So there's no time remaining in the game. It's just kind of who knows what happens.
So that's your spike at the end there. But yeah, so I think the last thing we wanted to do before we open to questions and the input from you guys is show you what it means to knit this thing into a HTML. So what you can do is, there are multiple file outputs you can have. You can have a PDF, HTML, I think you can go to Word doc even. But basically what it's going to do is it's going to take your notebook and it's going to transfer all of your, it's going to run all of your code, but it's also going to transfer your notes in a nice format. So it's got your notes as well as your code and your visualization. So Scott, you want to go ahead and hit knit to HTML? Might take a little bit.
Yeah, for you.
So yeah, that's what the file would look like in HTML. And then another thing I should mention about R Markdown, if you guys are familiar with LaTeX, you can embed LaTeX code straight into R Markdown, just your dollar signs. But yeah, if you guys have specific questions, or if you want to see like win probability charts for specific games, or any other visualizations you might need help with, Scott and I are going to be up here and also roaming around, so feel free to raise your hand.
Is that a win probability model? That's all based on like how good each team is. It's just like,
yeah, it's agnostic. Yeah, just game starts 50-50.
Yeah, okay.
Is this tutorial code like online where we get access to the?
So I showed you first thing like where you can get this. So if you go to the conference website and scroll all the way down here, and you just said demonstration file, I can download here. So if you just click that link, then you can download the file.
Yeah, and all of those chunks should be able, they should run on your machine as is. You just have to make sure you have those packages installed.
So it's the CSV file and the R code?
No, it's going to be just the R code. So what we ended up doing was the read CSV function that we used, you input a URL to it. So it loads it straight from the website. Right?
So you loaded the data from a URL, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what exactly did the NHL Scraper package do?
So the NFL Scraper package accesses the NFL.com's API, and it's getting the play-by-play. The only reason why they're just accessing it from the separate website right now is in case other people want to do it at the same time.
Okay.
NFL might do stop IP address kind of thing.
Okay, so normally you would get it.
Normally you just use, NFL right. Scraper package, season underscore play, underscore by, underscore play, season play-by-play, and there's a game play-by-play, and you will literally just download all the play-by-play for given game or given season.
And then that win probability, is that part of the NHL Scraper package?
Yeah, so
We have our model embedded within the package, and it gives the win probability values, the expected point values for every play. It's providing those estimates.
But, and that's part of the package.
Yep.
Right. So without the package, you don't have.
So all the complicated stuff that Brian Burke and Ron were talking about earlier, you don't have to replicate that. It's already in there.
Yep.